Ich möchte gerne zur Einleitung von Jodis Vortrag ganz kurz etwas zu ihrer Person sagen. Ich vermute, viele kennen sie ja auch bereits, oder ich weiß es auch von einigen, dass sie durch ihre Veröffentlichung gut kennen. Jodi ist Professorin für politische Theorie an dem Hobart and William Smith Colleges in Geneva, New York. Also politische Theorie und neue Medien, und vielleicht kennen auch manche sie eben genau über die neuen Medien als eine, wie sie sagt, Long-Term-Bloggerin, jetzt nicht mehr ganz so engagiert, aber eben doch mit einem großen Engagement. Ihre Veröffentlichungen, die jetzt, also die letzten zwei Bücher, die gerade im letzten Jahr, glaube ich, erschienen sind, ja, ist Democracy and Other Neoliberal Fantasies und Communist Horizon bei Verso. Und aktuell arbeitet sie an einem Buch, was auch demnächst dann erscheinen wird, über Crowds and Party. Vielen Dank und ja, willkommen, Jodi. Ja, okay. Bitte.
Thanks so much, Alex. Thank you all for coming. This evening, I want to consider the hypothesis that the last 5 years of riots and protests are the first phase of the revolt of the knowledge class. More specifically, my wager is that the protests associated with the Occupy movement, the Chilean student protests, the Montreal debt protests, the European anti-austerity protests, and even some components of the protests part of the Arab Spring, as well as multiple ongoing and intermittent strikes of teachers, civil servants, and medical workers all over the world, are best understood as the protests of the class of those proletarianized under communicative capitalism. These are not the struggles of the multitude. They're not struggles for democracy, and they're not struggles specific to local contexts. Nor are they merely the defensive struggles of a middle class facing cuts to social services, wage stagnation, unemployment, and declining home values. They are fronts in class war under the conditions of global communicative capitalism. Mainstream media babble about Facebook and Twitter revolutions was right, but for the wrong reasons. It was right to draw our attention to networked media, to suggest a link between the protests and ubiquitous communication networks, but it was wrong to think that protests are occurring because people can easily coordinate with social media, that they are primarily struggles for democracy, or that they are indications of a push for freedom on the part of network individuals. The revolts make sense as class struggle, as the political struggle of a knowledge class, of those whose work is exploited and whose lives are expropriated by communicative capitalism. I'm using the term knowledge class very broadly to designate those whose communicative activities generate value that is expropriated from them. So this is not knowledge class as the old bureaucracy or managerial class, but a new class of precarious communicative laborers. I have in mind both the wide expanse of informational and cultural production and the voluntary, unpaid, everyday activities of media use that are traced, stored, aggregated, and analyzed as a proprietary resource for capitalist accumulation. In our setting of communicative capitalism, paid, precarious, and unpaid labor should not be treated separately. As Enda Brophy and Grieg de Puter powerfully demonstrate, they constitute a circuit of exploitation. Brophy and de Puter use the smartphone to draw out this labor circuit, making it legible in terms of work common to a cybertariat. the circuit of exploitation around the smartphone moves from extraction, assembly, and design through mobile work, support work, and e-waste. By specifying the links between different sites of communicative production, analyses of circuits of exploitation illuminate opportunities for alliance and attack. They help us see, in other words, communication networks as networks of exploitation linking communicative labor across the social field. So where might we find support for the idea that we are witnessing an early phase of the class struggle of the knowledge class? Demographic data is a good place to start. In an analysis of Occupy Wall Street, Ruth Milkman, Stephanie Luce, and Penny Lewis find that highly educated young people were overrepresented among OWS activists and supporters, and that many were underemployed, indebted, or had recently lost jobs. A report based on data collected by Turkish security forces shows over half the Gezi Park protesters were in university or university graduates, even as their incomes were in the bottom economic half. Andre Singer, looking at the massive Brazilian protests of June 2013, likewise emphasizes the predominance of young, highly educated, and un- or underemployed adults. Singer finds that in protests in the 8 Brazilian state capitals, 43% of protesters had college degrees. In protests in Sao Paulo, nearly 80% had college degrees. Although these educational levels could suggest a middle class revolt, data on income and occupation point in the direction of the lower and lower middle class, the bottom half of society, where people are more likely to work as shop assistants, drivers, waiters, receptionists, and primary school teachers than they are as technicians or administrators. The educated are working in jobs formerly the domain of the lower class. To make sense of the disparity between high education and low incomes, Singer posits a new proletariat or precariat taking to the streets. Looked at most broadly, then, the demographics of recent protests point to heavy involvement by those who are young, well-educated, and un- or underemployed. Because of the tight labor market, they encounter a decreasing return on their investment in education. As they wind up in jobs for which they are overqualified, they end up pushing those without a college education out of the labor market entirely, thereby contributing indirectly to long-term unemployment. Incidentally, in 2013, the occupations employing the largest number of people in the U.S. were all service sector, retail sales, cashiers, food service, office workers, nursing, and customer service. To reiterate my point, the revolts of young, educated, un- and underemployed people across the globe are revolts of communicative labor. Ongoing labor struggles also support my hypothesis of the revolt of the knowledge or communicating class. Alongside the large-scale movements, there has been an array of strikes and actions by communicative laborers. Highly visible ones in the US include the protests of civil service workers in Wisconsin in 2011 and the Chicago teachers' strike of 2012. Globally, strikes of knowledge workers seem to be increasing. Here's a partial list from March 2014. There were strikes of public sector and airport workers in Germany, strikes by cleaners at the University of London, a telecom strike in Ghana, a sit-in at an airport in Sudan in protest over the contracting out of security jobs, strikes by teachers and education support workers in Western Australia, a strike by 7,000 doctors in South Korea opposing plans to introduce telemedicine and for-profit hospital subsidiaries. There were strikes by Greek civil servants, teachers, doctors, and pharmacists, and strikes by non-paid teaching staff and postal workers in India. Even this partial list of ongoing, active, but still disconnected struggles in the workplaces of the knowledge class supports the idea that the protests of the last few years are revolts of the cognitariat. At the same time, though, given changes in the workplace associated with increased use of technology, flexibilization, and precaritization, and linked to the decline of unions, we can't expect class struggle in communicative capitalism to be exclusively or even primarily in clearly delineated workplaces. Communicative production itself takes place throughout the social field. That a struggle doesn't take the form of a classic workplace struggle, in other words, doesn't mean that it's not class struggle. Student, debt, housing, and education protests need to be understood in terms of class politics, not issue politics. Likewise, that a primary organizational feature of the recent protests has been the general or mass assembly, often in parks or public squares, should not misdirect us away from class struggle. This is one of the interesting features of mainstream emphasis on the fact that occupiers are always on their phones, uploading video and tweeting and all the rest. For contingent and mobile workers, the park is a workplace. Their phones are means of production. When they occupy, they put these means of production to a use of their own choosing, not capital's. Demographics and workplace struggles support the idea of the revolt of the knowledge class. I now am going to turn to the basic idea of communicative capitalism and its implications for an understanding of the current setting of class struggle. Communicative capitalism names that form of late capitalism in which values heralded as central to democracy are materialized in networked communication technologies. Ideals of access, inclusion, discussion, and participation come to be realized through expansions, intensifications, and interconnections of global telecommunications. In communicative capitalism, capitalist productivity derives from its expropriation and exploitation of communicative processes. This does not mean that information technologies have replaced manufacturing. In fact, they drive a wide variety of mining, chemical, and biotechnological industries. Nor does it mean that networked computing has enhanced productivity outside the production of networked computing itself. Rather, it means that capitalism has subsumed communication such that communication does not provide a critical outside. Communication serves capital, whether in affective forms of care for producers and consumers, the mobilization of sharing and expression as instruments for human relations in the workplace, or contributions to ubiquitous media circuits. Other names for communicative capitalism are knowledge economy, information society, and cognitive capitalism. Although they are all trying to designate the same formation, each highlights something different. I highlight communication because I want to underscore the impact of this iteration of capitalism on democracy. Capitalism subsumes democracy, eliminating its capacity to designate a critical gap within the social field. What Jürgen Habermas theorized as communicative action doesn't provide a critical alternative to instrumental reason and the one-dimensional society. It doesn't because communication has become a primary means for capitalist expropriation and exploitation. Linguistic, affective, and unconscious being together have been co-opted for capitalist production. Marx's analysis of value in Capital helps explain how communication can be a vehicle for capitalist subsumption. In his well-known discussion of the commodity, Marx considers how it is that different sorts of goods can be exchanged with one another. His answer is human labor. Understood as quanta of time, labor renders different goods commensurable with one another. But how is this possible? Why would an hour of mining labor be commensurate with an hour of farming labor? The answer involves the fundamentally social character of labor. What is common to different kinds of human labor is that they are all labor in the abstract, components of the larger homogeneous mass of human labor. Labor, and hence value, is inextricable from the relations of production and reproduction constitutive of society. Products of labor are crystals of the social substance common to them all, that is to say, values. Communicative capitalism seizes, privatizes, and attempts to monetize the social substance without waiting for its crystallization in products of labor. It doesn't depend on the commodity thing. It directly exploits the social relation at the heart of value. Social relations don't have to take the fantastic form of the commodity to generate value for capitalism. Via networked, personalized communication and information technologies, capitalism has found a more straightforward way to appropriate value. One of the clearest expressions of communicative capitalism's direct exploitation of the social substance is Metcalfe's law. This law states that the value of a communications network is proportional to the square of the number of its users. The basic idea is that the more people using a network, the more valuable it is. The truth in Metcalfe's law is its association of value with the communicative network itself. Value is a property of the relations, the links between and within pages. Google's PageRank algorithm is one of the most successful information retrieval algorithms because it takes linking into account, mining and extracting common knowledge. PageRank puts to use the fact that networked communications are the form of capitalism's subsumption of the social substance to its terms and dynamics. Matteo Pasqualini thus argues that Google is a parasitic apparatus of capture of the value produced by common intelligence. He treats the prestige that PageRank attends to and reflexively enhances in terms of the network value of any given link. Network value describes a link's social relations. How many other links is it related to? Are those links related to other links? How many? Google captures this value, the link's social substance, its place within a general system of social relations. Communicative capitalism subsumes everything we do. It turns not just our mediated interactions, but all our interactions into raw material for capital. Financial transactions, interactions that are caught on video or are photographed, GPS location data, RFID tags, and soon the data generated by the multiple small ubiquitous sensors in what is called the Internet of Things enclose every aspect of our life into the data form. A few years ago, we might have understood this as a communicative commons. Now, with the absorption of a wide array of forms of unstructured data into massive data pools, it's clear that we are dealing with something even more all-encompassing. Big data is the capitalist name for this material that Marx understood as the social substance. Understanding the present in terms of communicative capitalism has repercussions for how we think about communication, subjectivity, and the social field. First, under communicative capitalism, messages are contributions. The idea of a message as something sent by a speaker to a receiver in order to elicit a response from that receiver no longer holds. Now, messages are contributions to circulating content. There's a shift from the primacy of a message's use value to the primacy of its exchange value, to its capacity to be circulated, forwarded, and counted. We see this shift in social media every time a platform takes off. What begins with a kind of intimacy as people interact around specific utterances, posts, updates, tweets, changes as more and more people join and the primary activity becomes one of forwarding. Unlike a message, which needs to be understood, a contribution is just to be added. One contributes one's opinion or idea to whatever discussion is going on. This additive feature of the contribution depends on a fundamental communicative equivalence. As a contribution, each message is communicatively equivalent to any other. What matters is not what was said, but that something was said. No opinion or judgment is worth more than any other, right? Each counts as one comment on my blog, or one like, or one tweet. Each adds something to the flow. Facts, theories, judgments, opinions, fantasies, jokes, lies, all circulate indiscriminately. The astronomical increases in information that our searching, commenting, and participating generate entrap us in a setting of communication without communicability. As contributions to circuits of information and affect, the content of our utterances is unimportant. Words are counted in word clouds, measured by numbers of times repeated rather than by their meaning. People increasingly circulate images rather than ideas, unsure how ideas will be interpreted or received. This decline in a capacity to transmit meaning, to symbolize beyond a limited discourse or immediate local context, characterizes communication's reconfiguration into a primarily economic form. Communicative production is for circulation more than use, for getting attention, not furthering understanding. Correlative to the change in communication is a change in subjectivity. Formerly powerful markers of symbolic identity, that place from which we judge ourselves, have withered away. The old political subjects of industrial worker and bourgeois citizen, split between public and private spheres, no longer organize action. As symbolic figures for politics, they've been critiqued, complicated, and pluralized. The material conditions that made them possible have been radically altered, not least through communicative capitalism. Think, for example, of the end of divisions between work and home, between being at work and being not at work, as well as the array of developments associated with deindustrialization, offshoring, post-Fordism, and informatization. A similar decline in symbolic efficiency affects racial, ethnic, gender, and sexual identifications. They too are less fixed, less stable, less available as determinate subject positions, although they remain sites of potent, intense struggle. Put in terms from Jacques Lacan, we see symbolic identities replaced by imaginary identities. Symbolic identity involves the subject's identification with an ego ideal, that is, with a perspective before whom the subject sees himself and his actions. Imaginary identification refers to the image that the subject adopts of himself. Symbolic identification, we might say, establishes the setting that determines which images appear and how it is that some are more compelling or attractive to us than others. Imaginary identification refers only to my self-image. The networked interactions of communicative capitalism do not provide symbolic identities, sites from which we see ourselves as loci of collective action. Rather, they provide opportunities for new ways for me to imagine myself, a variety of lifestyles that I can try and try on. This variety and mutability makes my imaginary identity extremely vulnerable. The frames of reference that give it meaning and value are forever shifting. The others who can rupture it might appear at any moment, and their successes, their achievements, call mine into question. This insecurity is not only psychic. It's a reasonable response to struggles to persist in global, reflexive, financial, and information networks. Many of us emphasize our unique individuality because our jobs depend on it. The social field of communicative capitalism is characterized by competition, division, and inequality. This is not an arena we can view in terms of a public sphere of rational deliberation and democratic decision making. It's one where numbers matter more than content, where how many takes the place of how come, where correlation displaces causation. The clearest exposition of the constituent role of inequality in communicative capitalism comes from Albert Laszlo Barabasi's discussion of power law distributions in complex networks. Complex networks, networks characterized by free choice, growth, and preferential attachment, have a specific structure. The top or most popular node has twice as many links as the second most popular, which is more than the one in third, and so on, such that there is very little difference among those at the bottom, but massive differences between top and bottom. Now, this might seem rare and not very significant. We tend to expect most distributions we encounter in everyday life to follow a bell curve. But the sorts of power law distributions we find in complex networks are actually really common. They characterize academic citation networks. Lots of articles are written, few are read. And they are the structure that produces blockbuster movies, best-selling novels, and giant internet hubs. The idea appears in popular media as the 80-20 rule, the winner-take-all or winner-take-most character of the new economy, and the long tail. In these examples, the one in first place emerges through the generation of a common field. Think, for example, of a competition like best weight loss app or best city tourism app. The contest generates a common field that will produce a winner. These commons can be generated in a variety of ways. In comments on a post. I don't know if y'all know Reddit. It's on the internet. And readers vote posts up and down. Web articles also generate comments. An example from the US is the Huffington Post, where their blogs offer a lot of clickbait to try to get one that would be most popular. And of course, Twitter. The more participation, the larger the field, the greater the inequality. That is, the greater the difference between the one and the many. Expanding the field produces the one. So in addition to the wide array of tried and true operations through which capitalists have always exploited workers, length of the working day, wage theft, speed ups, charging them for the means of production, communicative capitalism opens up new avenues for exploitation. Because the common is the general field out of which the one emerges, exploitation consists in efforts to stimulate the creative production of the field in the interests of finding and then monetizing the one. The best example of this is the Chinese website Kidian.com, which has 1 million registered writers and 100 million paying members. The writers receive fractions of a cent per 1,000-word update. To make enough money to survive requires writing hundreds of thousands of words a month, breaking down the division between physical and mental labor. The vast majority are stuck in the bottom. A lucky few, 29 actually, become platinum writers or big dogs, and some of their novels have been adopted for television. The power law distribution of nodes in complex networks, again, networks characterized by free choice and preferential attachment, tells us that inequality is a necessary feature of communicative capitalism. It is generated by the free flow of information through networks and then seized and exploited in the capitalist competition for profits. If we're honest, we have to admit that there's no such thing as social media. Digital media is class media. Networked communication doesn't eliminate hierarchy as we believed. It entrenches it as it uses our own choices against us. Changes in communication, imaginary over symbolic identity, and extreme inequality. With these as key features of communicative capitalism, what would we expect class struggle to look like? With respect to workplace struggles, we would expect more struggles among those in communicative labor, teachers, transport, service sector. We would expect struggles to extend beyond the workplace. So we would expect struggles to extend beyond the workplace, perhaps involving hacking as a kind of contemporary sabotage, as well as various kinds of communication devices. But more fundamentally, given the changes in communication and subjectivity, we would expect the expropriated to face real difficulties in organization, real difficulties in constructing clear narratives and symbols. We would expect images to take primacy over arguments, positions, and demands. We would expect intense attachment to individuality, difference, and uniqueness, attachments that would hinder solidarity. We would expect suspicion of those deemed to threaten that uniqueness. Micropolitics, issue politics, anarchism, one-off demonstrations, collectivism, and ironic events would, in this setting, seem more compelling, they would definitely be easier, than the sustained work of party building. And we would expect increasing focus on inequality. The concept of communicative capitalism thus makes the protests and revolts of the last few years legible as the class struggle of the proletarianized. It accounts for the insistence of personal media, the people protesting, the economic position of the protesters, and the political ambiguity of the protests. New proles often have a strong libertarian bent. They tend to present themselves as post-political, anti-political, right, as in the Spanish movement of the squares. They are so fluid and spongy that they can be channeled in different directions. They have a hard time uniting as a class, even as their actions are the expressions of a class. So what about the other side? In the recent years of riot and protest, if the recent years of riot and protest have been significant, we would expect a reaction from capital and the state, an intensification of surveillance and policing, a use of state resources to protect banks and corporations, and an attempt to return as quickly as possible to business as usual. We would expect capital and the state to try to turn protests into opportunities for capital accumulation, whether as content or opportunities for network growth. More than simply a reaction to the protests, this tendency to expropriation is one that directly opposes them. And big data makes this clear. More precisely, if crowds, demonstrators and occupiers, express a new common of collective struggle, then big data is an effort to enclose and expropriate this common. So I'm gonna talk some about big data to now show this other side of the capitalist expropriation of the networked energies that protest create. Two metaphors stick out in the rhetoric around big data: data as oil and data as gold. That is, fuel and money, something that powers and something that circulates. The oil and gold metaphors are telling in that they identify big data as the natural resource on which communicative capitalism relies. This resource, produced by all in common, is seized, enclosed, and privatized in a new round of primitive accumulation. In Capital's famous Part 8, Marx discusses the historic process divorcing the producer from the means of production. This process involved the forcible enclosure of the commons. Landlords, assisted by the law, expropriated for themselves what had belonged to the people in common. Property based on the labor of the owner is thereby replaced with property based on capitalist ownership. David Harvey rightly points out that far from existing outside of capitalist processes as some sort of origin, the practices associated with primitive accumulation coexist with capitalism. He thus emphasizes accumulation by dispossession, associating various schemes of privatization, financialization, and commodification with a new enclosure of the commons. Dispossession, rather than happening all at once, is an ongoing process. No one will deny the ongoingness of data dispossession. Sometimes it's blatant. The announcement that our call will be monitored for quality assurance. the injunctions to approve again Apple's privacy changes, the necessity of renewing passwords and credit card information. Sometimes the ongoingness is more subtle, naturalized in maps, GPS signals, video surveillance, and the RFID tags on and in items that we purchase. And sometimes the ongoingness is completely beyond our grasp, as when data sets are combined and mined so as to give states and corporations actionable data for producing products, patterns, and policies based on knowing things about our interrelations one to another that we do not know ourselves. Here, the currents of lives as they are lived are frozen into infinitely separable, countable, and combinatory data points. There is, however, a strangeness to data dispossession that differentiates it from the dispossession that accompanies debt, privatization, and foreclosure. Big data dispossesses us of a certain kind of temporality and a certain kind of being together. These are expropriated from us and put to alien use. Two kinds of temporality are expropriated: the momentary and the futural. We lose the momentary because everything leaves a storable trace. Moving through space with a mobile phone creates data. Touching a screen, looking at a screen creates data. Rather than a time of instance, we have a time of permanence. In this time, mistakes, errors, and lies coexist with corrections. Learning, falsifiability, become attributes of systems, of algorithms, rather than dimensions of meaning. We lose a dimension of futurity in that a primary mode of data analysis is predictive, the search for patterns in order to predict and intervene in the future, even if that future is only microseconds ahead, as happens in high-frequency trading. In each case, data analytics try to eliminate surprise, the very possibility that something could happen that's actually inseparable from futurity. The expropriation of these temporalities exemplifies and intensifies the decline of symbolic efficiency. Stored moments are emptied of contexts, so many instants to be reassembled on demand. Similarly, futurity becomes detached from narratives of possibility, plans we might make, and visions we might pursue, fragmented into so many options for prediction and arbitrage, available to government and finance, but not to us. Data dispossession changes our modes of being together by making them available for the private commercial gain of another. In the words of a 2014 World Economic Forum report on big data, quote, "Our collective discussions, comments, likes, dislikes, and networks of social connections are now all data, and their scale is massive," end quote. Sociality is enclosed, analyzed for past patterns, and held for future ones in the interest of squeezing out some competitive advantage. Communication, culture, and care are seized and tagged. We can do nothing that is not already for capital. Understood as the basic resource of communicative capitalism, big data has the characteristic of being self-renewing. It's inexhaustible, coextensive with the reproduction of social life. It reaches through and beyond work, even beyond the reproduction of workers, into the social substance itself. A contribution to the World Economic Forum Global Information Technology Report from 2014 on the rewards and risks of big data describes the potential for gains of $14.4 trillion in added value in the commercial sector over the next 10 years. So now I have a quote from this report from the World Economic Forum Global Information Technology Report. This opportunity exists in the form of new value created by technology innovation, market share gains, and increasing competitive advantage. It translates into an opportunity to increase global corporate profits by approximately 21%, driven by improvements in asset utilization, reducing costs and improving capital efficiency, employee productivity, improved labor efficiency, supply chain logistics, eliminating waste and improving process efficiency, customer experience, adding more customers, and innovation, reducing time to market, end quote. Value here is a matter of capital accumulation by the capitalist class. It accumulates from cutting the labor force, right, in their language, reducing costs and supply chain logistics, squeezing the remaining workers, improved labor efficiency, trying to get people to spend more money, and becoming more competitive. This last benefit is necessarily short-term. Even if big data gives a competitive advantage to early adopters, as it becomes standard, that competitive edge will diminish. Right? This is the case with the adoption of any technology. Approached in terms of class struggle, big data looks like further escalation of capital's war against labor. If earlier waves of automation displaced industrial workers, big data portends the displacement of post-industrial or knowledge workers. It should come as no surprise, then, that education and healthcare, two of the last remaining sites of intensive, face-to-face, relatively high-paying labor, are often singled out in media, industry, and governmental discussions of big data. An excellent study, The Future of Employment, by Carl Benedict Frey and Michael Osborne, explains why this is the case. Historically, those tasks could be computerized, which followed clear rule-based routines. Too many variables meant too hard to program. Big data breaks through this technological barrier as it enables non-routine tasks to be rendered as well-defined problems. Frey and Osborne write, "With data, objective and quantifiable measures of success of an algorithm can be produced, which aid the continual improvement of its performance relative to humans. As a result, computerization is no longer confined to routine tasks that can be written as rule-based software queries, but is spreading to every non-routine task where big data becomes available." Examples include robotics, Google's driverless cars, and the development of voice recognition capacities that let call centers replace people with algorithms. They include as well the kind of knowledge work previously seen as invulnerable. Frey and Osborne find that 47% of total U.S. employment is at risk of being automated within the next two decades. Massive amounts of data allow an array of decision-making tasks to be automated: medical diagnoses and treatment, fraud detection, legal services, ad design, purchase and placement, and stock trading. Education is also a key front. So to conclude, the revolts of the past few years exemplify class struggle under communicative capitalism. Accepting this position, right, so if you agree with me, this entails then rejecting the idea that the struggles of the last few years are primarily post-political, democratic, or strictly local movements. It entails as well a recognition of changes in class struggles' mode of appearance. It looks different under conditions of distributed, precarious, and unpaid communicative labor from how it appeared during the industrial labor movement. Finally, it entails thinking about the form of current struggles in light of their setting in communicative capitalism. Fragmentation, the use of images over demands, and being out of doors are not remarkable tactical innovations and advances. They are practical responses to a setting in which our communicative engagements are expropriated from us.
For the translation, you know. Gibt es Henning? Henning?
Oh.
Yeah, yeah, Henning will give you one.
Maybe we should clap for our translator.
Yeah. Eine Sekunde. Ja, also Jodi, vielen Dank für diesen, wie ich finde, fantastisch reichen Vortrag. So you get it, yeah, okay. Für den fantastisch reichen Vortrag mit so vielen interessanten Aspekten über Proteste, die Rolle von Kommunikation, die Art der Akkumulation durch Enteignung im Bereich von Big Data und Kommunikation und der Erzeugung von völlig neuen Formen von Ungleichheiten. Ja, so ich glaube, das ist wirklich ein beeindruckendes Panorama, was einen auch nicht fröhlicher stimmt nach manchen skeptischen oder pessimistischen, leicht pessimistisch machenden Ausführungen schon heute Nachmittag. Also ja, die Diskussion. Ja, bitte. Geht das ohne Mic oder do you need a mic? No, please.
Ja, ich habe ein kleines Problem mit Wert und Preis und Kosten. Meines Erachtens wird weder in der Finanzindustrie noch in der Kommunikationsindustrie Wert geschaffen. Es wird umverteilt, massiv der Wettbewerb zugunsten von einigen Unternehmen, die eben über Data Mining verfügen, steigert die Wettbewerbsposition gegenüber anderen Unternehmen, die dann entsprechend aus dem Markt gedrängt werden. In der Makroökonomie gibt es keine Kosten, weil die Kosten des einen sind die Einnahmen des anderen. Also das heißt, wenn wir davon sprechen, dass Data Mining und ähnliche Mittel eingesetzt werden, dann führt es zu einem verstärkten Akkumulationskampf an der Spitze und Verdrängungswettbewerb im Kapitalismus. Aber Werte selbst werden nicht geschaffen, sondern es wird eigentlich Geld umverteilt, weil da wird nichts produziert. Es ist eine Dienstleistung. Es ist eine Leistung, die als Vorleistung für die Produktion eigentlich geschaffen wird, zumindest in der makroökonomischen Theorie.
Do you want to answer immediately? easier for you? Yeah. Okay, good, yeah.
I have two answers to that. Do you want a headphone or? Yeah. Doesn't want to hear the answer. Okay, so I have two answers. The first answer is that the capitalists think that there is value being created, and they put that at $14.4 trillion, right? Right? I mean, so on the one hand, it's kind of, so we can just, if we can look at what they think and accept that as at least one position worth considering. Okay, so they think they're creating value. And one can agree or disagree with that claim, but I think that's worth holding on to. Second, I think that we need to understand them as creating value if we recognize that the source of value is the social substance, and that there is a, that what we see in communicative capitalism is a deeper reach into sociality to turn our very relations into something that is seized and used for capital. It's a different mode of value. I would say it's value seizure, right? Taken from the you know, our base, you know, our basic substance that's being expropriated from us. So it's not, I actually think it is a Marxian account of value, but this at the level of what is the location of value? It comes from the social substance, right? It's a value is a crystallization of the social substance, Marx says in the beginning of Capital. And so this is what's being seized. We're the ones creating it, right? We create it in our social relations. The capitalists aren't creating it, right? They're taking it. And so this is a mode of that seizure. And they recognize that, $14.4 trillion worth.
Katrin, du hattest dich gemeldet? Ja, okay.
Ja, vielen Dank für diesen wirklich diese beeindruckende These auch, die mir sehr eingeleuchtet hat von der Ausbeutung unserer quasi so der Kommunikation. Also diese ganze analytische Ebene hat mir sehr eingeleuchtet. Meine Frage zielt eigentlich auf die These, dass das, was wir jetzt beobachten, eben Klassenkämpfe sind und nicht Kämpfe um, also Issue Politics, sondern Class Struggle. Und da wäre jetzt meine Frage, wie es zu dieser These kommt, also ob dafür nicht auch Bedingung wäre, dass diejenigen, die an diesen verschiedenen Kämpfen beteiligt sind, sich selber als Klasse verstehen oder die Analyse eigentlich in dem Sinne vornehmen, wie sie sie jetzt geleistet haben. Also auch die Frage, welche, das ist vielleicht eine Frage, die mich eben auch zu den Beiträgen von heute Nachmittag noch führt, also die Frage, was überhaupt die Kritik, das kritische Bewusstsein für eine Rolle spielt in diesen ganzen Prozessen, emanzipatorischen Prozessen, und ob das nicht eher eine Beobachtung von außen ist, aber die Beteiligten selber würden sich vielleicht gar nicht so verorten. Und die Frage ist, ist das egal? Also können wir von außen sagen, was die tun, oder müsste da nicht auch ein Bewusstsein, ein Klassenbewusstsein vorhanden sein? Und das führt mich, also diese Frage habe ich mir vor allem gestellt, weil Sie auch sagen, es gibt diesen Shift von den Symbolic Identities zu diesen, wie war der Begriff? Imaginary Identities. Und das sieht doch schon danach aus, dass da irgendwie eben auch überhaupt die, ja, das Medium einer kritischen Durchdringung, auch einer Identifizierung jetzt vielleicht mit kritischen Kategorien fehlt. Also wenn es dann nur noch mit Bildern möglich ist, sich überhaupt allenfalls als politisches Subjekt zu formieren. Also das wäre eigentlich die Frage, was das für eine Klasse ist.
I think that this critical awareness that I'm describing is not something from the outside at all, but from within and manifest in of a whole variety of practices, and that the practices of continued revolt are one element of this, that the way that these revolts have, particularly in the last 5 years, become present to themselves as one struggle is astounding. I mean, it's quite amazing that people in Wisconsin identified themselves with people in Tahrir Square, and then people in Turkey identified themselves with people in Occupy Wall Street, and people in Occupy Wall Street identified themselves with folks in Montreal, and so on and so forth. A whole series of struggles, from 2011 on, have become legible as one struggle. How is that? If it was issue politics, it wouldn't be one thing. But we actually all know and feel it as one thing. That tells me that we have something like an initial phase of the revolt of communicative labor or a communicative class. So I think the practices are a demonstration of this, and the self-awareness of the practices is one struggle. Now, aren't there still multiple different ways of interpreting this? Yes, but the practice also says that, oh, it's not multiple, it's not 25 different separate struggles, it's one. So I think that we can see a tension inside the movements of the movements themselves, and then we can draw out, for political reasons, one version of that, right? One side of that. And so it is a political claim to try to think about these as a form of class struggle under communicative capitalism, right? It's deliberately to draw out a politics of this, to push it in one direction rather than let it go fragmenting all over again in a whole bunch of multiple directions. You brought up the very strong point about these problems of identification. And I think two things. I think that there is potential for, as the movements themselves feel like one movement, they exert a force back on themselves. So with respect to Occupy Wall Street, the single name, Occupy, had an effect back on the movement itself. In the first few weeks, people wondered about, well, maybe there are libertarians in it who support Ron Paul, who is this libertarian politician. But they were kind of quickly pushed out, right? Or they didn't recognize themselves under this name anymore. So a common name has an effect back on the movement itself. Similarly, the use of common images has effects back on their users. So I think it's conceivable, and that's the direction I want to push, that there can be a more emergent symbolic identity, but I don't think we're quite there yet. I think we're still at the level of imaginary identities functioning as strange attractors and constellating energies around them, but that the more they work back on the people who use them, we see a symbolic identity emerging.
Okay. Ganz hinten an der Wand, ne? Du hattest dich gemeldet.
I'm not sure. You already spoke to a lot of what I wanted to ask, actually. But thank you. It was one of the most interesting lectures I've heard in a long time. But my question was also about specifically about the lack of class consciousness. Okay, not just people who are in Occupy, but the sort of people, the group that you were talking about overeducated and underemployed. And these are people that are really grew up in the middle class with expectations of a middle class life and are still living symbolically and mentally in the middle class and are not, in general, in my experience, not reconciling themselves with the reality of their precarious positions. Like, I think you see this all the time at universities, where university students and graduate students seem like it somehow in shock and isolated and individualized and don't seem to understand that they're living inside of exploitative working conditions and still buy into the sort of the Leistungsgesellschaft, whatever the fantasy is that they're going to be, they're going to work their way up the ladder. And so I guess that's what I'm interested in is how that, and Lauren Berlant talks about that, that like the attrition of the good life fantasy slowly seeps into the middle class, and that's actually the point where it becomes a crisis, and what's actually a norm for the traditional proletariat becomes a crisis when it seeps into the middle class. And so I'm wondering how that affects, how that lack of consciousness of these people constituting a new precarious class affects these movements, and also, like, yeah, so what do we do?
Thanks so much. So the lack of consciousness is always a problem for any, you know, communist revolution, any Marxist analysis. Rosa Luxemburg worried about the individualization facing any workers and the way that workers' competition with each other isolates them from one another, right? Class consciousness is always kind of a problem. That's not unique to the middle class or to a kind of middle class crisis. I think it's important to always push that point and to keep that in mind, because I think that there's a way that that somehow the lack of consciousness seems like a kind of damning argument rather than always a problem of how do collectives feel their collective force. I think that's, oh, and how do we get around this, right? You know, organize. I don't mean that quickly, I just... A few more words.
Maybe it could be of interest for all of us. On that. How to organize against our
dispossession, the primitive
accumulation that's happening to us when we use Facebook.
Like,
what would it look like to organize?
Don't use Facebook. Well, but no, I think actually that's a good. I think it's more. One of the reasons I spend all of this, you know, detailed time on like RFID tags in this paper is to give us a sense now that it doesn't even matter if you don't have a cell phone and don't use Facebook, right? If you have a bank card or a credit card, then you're already co-opted. If you walk past a place with a video camera, you're already taken in. So there's not an escape. Right, so that's the first part. So there's not, it's not like you can be dispossessed. So the only thing that we can do is take it back. Right, I mean, I think of this as a strong argument for how we are. I mean, our relations are the means of production, right? So it is a matter of we have to take this for ourselves as a collective. Right, that doesn't mean anyone.
Dann Lukas, dann deine? Ja, ja. Also, okay, jetzt machen wir es mal so. Axel, Lukas, dann die beiden. Ich weiß nicht, wer von euch zuerst. Ja, nein, ich meine, das ist klar, aber von du und Lisa, das weiß ich nicht. Aber ihr seid danach. Okay, sag mal.
Ja, ne?
Ich halt nehme wegen der Kamera, es tut mir leid. Ja, die Kamera steht genau so im Pult. Das ist auch so im Leben.
Wir haben getauscht, Alex, dass du jetzt nicht irritiert bist. Nein, einverständlich. Ja, vielen Dank, Jodi, für die Analyse. Ich stimme in sehr, sehr vielem zu. Ich muss aber noch mal eine Gegenrede zu deiner These zur Klasse machen, ausgehend von den Bewegungen, anknüpfend an die Frage und den Kommentar von Katrin Meyer. Ich arbeite seit langem zu den Bewegungen und so weiter und so weiter. Das heißt, ich weiß, von was ich spreche, dass, und ich sehe überhaupt keinen Diskurs und keine Praxis eines Kampfes, sondern wenn, dann gibt es sicherlich vielleicht nicht historisch neu, aber erstaunlich, wie es stattfand seit 2011, eine Assoziation oder eine Verbundenheit, eine Verlinkung von Kämpfen, die eher, das ist jetzt auch nicht das tolle Wort, aber ein Netzwerk von Kämpfen ist. Und ich verstehe dein Bedürfnis nicht, diese Heterogenität und dieses Experimentieren neuer politischer Praxen und auch Relationalität oder von Kämpfen wieder festzufrieren in die traditionelle Vorstellung einer Klasse, von der ich auch noch nicht sehe, wie sie vielleicht den Klassenbegriff benutzt, aber neu definiert zum Beispiel. Das ist das eine. Das andere, was ich aber fragen wollte, ist, deine These war, dass die Revolten die ersten Praxen, das erste Gesicht, hast du gesagt, einer Revolte wir gesehen haben oder wir beobachten können, die entstanden ist, im Entstehen ist aus der kommunikativen Kapitalismus. Und du sagst, es ist nicht postpolitisch, es ist nicht demokratisch. Was ist es dann? Ich vermute, du kannst was dazu sagen, was es an politischer Praxis ist, was da entsteht. Das wollte ich dich fragen, da nochmal deutlicher zu sagen, was du findest, was aus diesem kommunikativen Kapitalismus an politischer Formierung vielleicht entstehen könnte. Und nicht, das ist nicht die Frage nach der Klasse, ne?
So for the definition of a class, I'm thinking about a class here as communicative producers. So it's a class of producers, but it's really a very broad idea of communicative producers, which is why I also made it analogous to a knowledge class. And I think that we see, wait a minute, that's a new, I suppose it's stupid. The practices associated with this have been practices of realizing ourselves as collectivities and taking common places, right? Sylvia Federici uses, and David Harvey too, will use the expression of commoning. But I think that rather than kind of link that to sort of urban gardens, it makes sense to think of all of the occupation of public spaces in these, you know, they're only temporary, but as forms of a collectivization of common areas. And that one of the things that's really manifest in these movements is the push to be and experience one another as these big collectives. I don't see these in terms of, I don't see how anybody could to see these in terms of all of this heterogeneity, because that's what we had during the alter globalization movement. That was emphasized all the way through, right? Multiple different affinity groups come together at a particular place, everybody, you know, flies in, walks in, whatever, do your thing, and then splits. But what we've seen in these things are variety of different groups holding themselves together in common ways. What is different is the common part, not the heterogeneity part. That's why 2011 has been a break, is the collective, this collective slash common dimension has been the big thing. So I think that network of struggle characterized the alter-globalization movement, But it's not what we've seen since 2011. Now, the harder question is the what's emerging as a political formation. And I think that's in flux, right? Whether or not this new communicative class, as you know, in this broad way, has a political, is going to be able to generate political power is still an open question. Yeah. Did I answer all of your parts, even if unsatisfyingly?
The direction of the question to the, ja, auf Deutsch, also die, warum ich gefragt habe nach der politischen Formierung, ist ein bisschen, um dich dahin zu bringen, mehr dazu zu sagen, ob es Anfänge eines, wie auch immer, neu verstandenen Kommunismus sind. Was ja ein Teil deiner These oder deiner Arbeit ist.
Yes, and that's the direction we're definitely going.
Nein, nein. Jo, das machen wir noch nicht. Noch ein bisschen. Wir können das ja noch ein bisschen ausbauen, bis in die Idee zu kommen.
Ja, Axel Rüdiger. Ja, ich fand das auch sehr interessant und sehr gut, also gerade diesen Aspekt, also der Klassenanalyse auf dieses Phänomen des Kommunikationskapitalismus zu übertragen. Ja, wenn ich es richtig verstanden habe, ist das Argument ja auch gewesen, dass die kommunikative Tätigkeit im weitesten Sinne unter den Bedingungen des Kommunikationskapitalismus eigentlich genau das oder dem entspricht, was Marx sozusagen ja als abstrakte Arbeit bezeichnet hat. Ja, also korrigieren Sie mich, also korrigiere mich, wenn ich es falsch verstanden habe, aber ich denke, dass die Ausführung ja in die Richtung geht, dass eigentlich das, was entsteht, sozusagen eigentlich das so ein Archetypus oder Idealtypus von abstrakter Arbeit ist. Und das sozusagen, wenn man also die Klassenfrage da reinbringt, dass es eben sozusagen nicht nur um Heterogenitäten, um Netzwerke geht, sondern dass es sozusagen in diesen Differenzstrukturen und Widerstandsstrukturen also eine Differenz gibt, die über alle anderen Differenzen quasi politisch hinausgeht. Also die Laclau oder meinetwegen sagen, die Grenze zwischen Differenz und Äquivalenz quasi darstellt. Und wenn ich es richtig verstanden habe, ist das eben die Differenz zwischen Kapital und Arbeit, die sich sozusagen unter diesen Bedingungen eben reproduziert. Und die Klassen, die dann entstehen, gehen diesen Konflikt ja nicht voraus, sondern sozusagen entstehen ja erst durch diesen Konflikt. Und in dem Sinne wird es quasi eben auch Sinn machen, in diese Richtung zu gehen. Ich habe da noch eine Verständnisfrage. Am Anfang war die Rede davon, dass sozusagen der Kommunikationskapitalismus also direkt auf die soziale Substanz zugreift, die man eben als abstrakte Arbeit verstehen kann. Aber ich war mir nicht ganz sicher, ob ich es richtig verstanden habe. Ich hatte den Eindruck, dass er sozusagen nicht mehr den Umweg über eine Ware gehen muss. Am Anfang spielte das mal kurz eine Rolle. Und da war ich mir nicht ganz sicher, ob ich das richtig verstanden habe. Also ob die Produktion von Wert im Kommunikationskapitalismus, also vollständig sozusagen von der Warenproduktion im gegenständlich-materiellen Sinne eben abgelöst ist, in dem Sinne. Oder ob sich sozusagen eben Warenstrukturen anders reproduzieren, sozusagen, also durch die Zirkulation und die Produktion von Informationen. Ja, das war diese Verständnisfrage. Ansonsten mal vielen Dank für den tollen Vortrag.
Thanks for the question. So there's obviously, there's still commodity production. There's still forms of rents and agrarian production. But there's also a new layer. And this new layer is one of the direct subsumption of sociality for capitalist productivity. Right. I mean, even for the actual for the generation of capitalist value, right? Value for capitalism. And this is a direct subsumption of sociality that happens without having to go through the commodity form. So, for example, my sense of some theories from the 80s and 90s is that there was a worry about the commodification of social relations, and that this commodification of relations was the problem. And what I'm trying to say is communicative capitalism doesn't have to go through commodities. It can take social relations directly. And the example to explain that is Google. Because the way that Google is able to take just our linking practices, the relations that our choices have, deep even behind our backs, right? The relation of other people's choices to my choices, other people's preferences to my preferences, and sees that directly for a whole variety of different capitalist purposes. And then the big data is the even, further manifestation of this direct capitalist seizure of the social field without having to go through the commodity form. So yes, there's still commodities, but there's this other layer that's happening.
Ja, vielen Dank auch von meiner Seite für diesen Vortrag mit viel Nachdenkstoff. Wo ich so ein bisschen eine Nachfrage hätte, ist bei der Begriffsbildung. Also erstmal kommunikative Klasse, communicative class. Weil da ist so ein bisschen die Frage, ich meine, Bourgeoisie kommuniziert ja auch so, ne? Also was ist das Spezifikum der produzierenden Klasse in der Frage nochmal? Und dann sozusagen die Frage auch aufwerfend, wenn wir dann über Arbeiterinnenklasse sprechen, ist die gesamte Arbeiterinnenklasse jetzt kommunikativ geworden oder gibt es sozusagen innerhalb der Arbeiterinnenklasse unterschiedliche Fraktionen, wo eine Fraktion der Arbeiterinnenklasse die kommunikative ist, während es andere Teile gibt, die zum Beispiel industrielle Arbeiterinnenklasse sind, die das nicht sind und dann vielleicht auch noch eine Fraktion existiert, die du ja beschrieben hast, als die, die sozusagen aus dem Arbeitsprozess gedrängt wird, weil gerade die kommunikative Klasse zunehmend ihre Aufgaben übernimmt und zunehmend überhaupt nur abgehängt ist und arbeitslos oder völlig verarmt ist. Und darin anschließend dann die Frage, wenn du ja sagen würdest zu so einem Begriff der Klassenfraktionen innerhalb der Arbeit, wie sie sich untereinander und zueinander verhalten im Klassenkampf und was auch Perspektiven von Bündnissen sind, weil man ja darüber diskutieren könnte, ob sozusagen die Bewegungen, die wir in den letzten Jahren erlebt haben, Ausdruck dieser kommunikativen Klassenfraktion ist, aber schon nochmal spannend wäre, was mit den passivierten Teilen der Arbeiterinnenklasse passiert.
So I used an example from these Canadian communication theorist, Enda Brophy. Actually, he's Irish, but he works in Canada. Enda Brophy and Greg DePuyter, as they look at this circuit of exploitation. And they're developing, they're using the communicative capitalism concept as they develop this idea of the circuit of exploitation. And as I mentioned, they focus on the cell phone. And one of the reasons that this is really interesting for this kind of class analysis is it lets them trace a variety of kinds of labor through this particular instrument, commodity, means of production, facet of or node of social relations. So it can go all the way from extractive mining through the the assembly of the phone, the technology, all the way through the different uses of it to its discarding. That lets you get a really large account of different kinds of labor as connected around and through the cell phone. I think that that's useful because it lets us not worry about thinking about working class politics in terms of predetermined accounts of which part of the labor force we have in mind, but instead see how different parts of the labor force are already connected in this circuit. So there are multiple, basically here, all sorts of different kinds of labor are already there around one thing, right? Whether or not it's mining or assembly line or just everyday kinds of use. You can talk about unpaid labor, precarious labor, and wage labor with this analysis of a circuit of exploitation. I think that that's helpful, and that it's a way to start bringing back in class analysis under the kinds of, under communicative capitalism or under our contemporary condition. I'm not sure if that answers your question exactly, but I can't answer it in the form that you asked it. You want to try again, or no?
Okay, enough for him.
Ja, ich möchte mich auch für den spannenden Vortrag bedanken. Genau, ich habe jetzt ein paar Fragen. Ich versuche sie zu fokussieren. Die eine Frage ist, ich habe mir die Bewegung ein bisschen angeschaut, von denen du gesprochen hast. Und es ist immer interessant, welcher Aspekt am meisten im Vordergrund rückt, je nachdem, welche Fragestellung ein Mensch an sich stellt. Ich habe sie mir unter der Frage ihrer demokratischen Forderungen angesehen und hätte zum Beispiel vielleicht das verbindendes Moment eher eine grundlegende Kritik an der stark hierarchischen Organisation der Gesellschaft, was halt auch bis in die Arbeitsbereiche geht, gelesen, eben auch ausgehend von der hohen Qualifizierung der Personen, die an diesen Bewegungen teilnehmen. Also das ist so eine Sache. Und deswegen frage ich mich, was eigentlich, aber das andere ist, was auch sehr interessant ist, dass sich sehr viele verschiedene Forderungen in diesen Kämpfen sammeln. Und für mich stellt sich so ein bisschen die Frage, was denn der Mehrwert ist, das Ganze als Klassenkampf also zu bezeichnen. Also welche neuen Strategien würden sich damit eröffnen, weil tatsächlich hätte ich nirgendwo innerhalb dieser sozialen Bewegungen gesehen, dass diese Kritik, wie du sie jetzt getätigt hast, Teil ihres Selbstverständnisses und ihrer Forderungen sind. Genau, und das Zweite, was ich mich frage, weil du meintest, also ich würde dir zustimmen, so technisch, dass die Big Data über Statistik zu sehr viel Automatisierung führen kann, was viele Bereiche kommunikative Arbeit ablöst, nur daraus dann eine Entstehung eines Klassenkampfs daraus zu schließen, dass sich darin ein Klassenkampf entzündet, ist insofern historisch für mich ein bisschen erstaunlich, weil zum Beispiel die steigende Automatisierung auch jetzt in Bezug auf die Industrialisierung nicht der Moment war, in dem der Klassenkampf sich entzündet hat, sondern eigentlich eher, wo er eine erste Schwächung, oder nicht eine erste, aber auch eine Schwächung erlebt hat. Genau.
Also ich würde jetzt die Diskussion, also es gibt noch eine Wortmeldung von Dirk und dann würde ich die Diskussionsliste schließen. Ja, wenn es, oder gibt es noch hinter der Kamera? Okay, Jodi.
So I guess I'm surprised at the end of your point where you mentioned automation as a weakening, because I would have taken actually the Italian autonomist position here, where the automation is a response to strength, right? That's why that comes in. And so, so you're with me on that part, or at least you know the move, right? Whether or not. The variety of demands. I mean, the variety of demands makes sense for people who have been politicized under communicative capitalism since 1989, right? What has been the dominant ideology? The dominant ideology says you're different, you're unique, do your own thing, realize yourself, get what you can, don't compromise, be all that you can be, all sorts of crap like that. So the first phase makes sense in terms of a multiplicity of self-assertions, but also the multiplicity of self-assertions experienced itself coming together in collectives and in common spaces, and started to realize the ways that the multiplicity wasn't necessarily useful, and there had to be larger processes of trying to pull together, consolidate, work these out. But we're still pretty, I mean, we didn't get further than that, right? What, oh no, that's false. We got a little further in that folks really started to have a lot of response to privatization and neoliberalism. That's critique of capitalism. Right, all of the anti-privatization stuff, anti-banks, anti-corporate stuff, that is a kind of anti-capitalism. In Occupy Wall Street, the things that were inspiring to people were people's library, people's clinic, people's kitchen. I mean, my God, you know, you attach people's to something and you've got the 1960s, right? That's socialist struggle. So I think that what we were starting to see was an appreciation for communist possibility that is still nascent and present, and now folks are moving into, you know, we can hope, into more developed versions of that. Exactly how that would play out, you know, no one can predict. But I think if we look in the best directions, that we find the collectivity coming to understand itself as such.
Ja, auch von meiner Seite nochmal ganz herzlichen Dank für den schönen Vortrag. Auch ich stoße mich so ein bisschen an dieser Terminologie, dass wir eine neue Form des Klassenkampfes erleben und möchte das an zwei, vielleicht drei Punkten erläutern. Der erste Punkt ist, ich glaube, zum Klassenkampf bedarf es einer gewissen Konstanz, vielleicht auch einer gewissen Struktur, was wir erlebt haben bei Occupy, bei den Protesten in Nordafrika und vor allem auch in der Türkei und in Südeuropa, die waren vergleichsweise kurzlebig. Der zweite Punkt ist, das hat Lukas, glaube ich, angesprochen, mit den Fraktionen innerhalb des Klassenkampfes. Also was wir auch beobachten konnten, ist der Punkt, dass es ein spezifisches Milieu war, das sich versammelt hat und dass es den Herrschenden gelungen ist, gerade die Subaltern gegen dieses Milieu auszuspielen. Also USA Tea Party Bewegung ist zum Beispiel so ein etwas, was doch in gewisser Weise diese Logik des Klassenkampfes doch in der fundamentalen Frage gestellt hat, beziehungsweise anders formuliert: Hatten wir nicht eine Form eines Kampfes von Leuten, die gewohnt waren, in privilegierten Positionen zu sein, die diese Privilegien verloren haben und dann damit versucht haben, andere auszugrenzen, also auch Subalterne auszugrenzen? Der dritte Punkt...
Wait, I don't understand the last part.
Okay, the last point, also... Part. Okay, Occupy Wall Street, es war ein spezifisches Milieu, es waren die kognitiven Arbeiter, wie du sie genannt hattest, die doch von den ganzen Praktiken sich sehr stark unterschieden haben von denjenigen, die zum Beispiel die Tea Party unterstützt haben. Und hier wäre die Frage, ob es nicht eher ein Mittelklassenphänomen gewesen ist, dass eher... nicht sich nicht unbedingt in der Terminologie eines Klassenkampfes, sondern eines Kampfes der Verteidigung von Mittelklassenprivilegien sich artikulieren müsste.
Okay, so I'm going to start, though, with your beginning North Africa. First, I don't think short-lived is correct. The struggle in Egypt had been going on over 10 years before the Egyptian Revolution. Second, that struggles ebb and flow, that they come to a head at some points and then diminish at other times. That is the history of class struggle. So that it's, you know, that there's been some more submersion is no big deal, or like the when we just don't know yet what else is going to happen there. So I don't think it is correct to assume that it has to continue with the exact same momentum in every place all the time, or it doesn't count as class struggle. With respect to the Tea Party is a front group funded by the Koch brothers and other billionaires to mobilize right-wing sentiments, and pay, and they pay people. So I don't think you can give any grassroots credibility to the Tea Party at all. And the Occupy Wall Street, I don't think it's right to talk about it as a struggle for the middle class defending itself where it was, because that doesn't let you recognize the change in where it was, the change in society because of communicative capitalism, and the broader array of people participating in the movement. So, like, when you say something like middle class trying to protect its position, that makes it seem like you would expect most people to be, 40 to 60 year old, people who have really lost their jobs, rather than so many young people who didn't experience a kind of middle-class security, but who are actually facing a different kind of world. So they didn't have the security, but they have essentially a kind of abyss and hopelessness. So I think that that it's a mistake. I mean, I think it's a mistake that somehow wants to diminish the achievements of the movement. It's like, oh my God, we can't get our hopes up to think that this might be something better. It really has to be, just some sort of depressing middle class kind of thing, blah, blah, blah. But if you look at it this other way, particularly in light of what was happening in Brazil and the really good work from Andre Singer, and then look at it in terms of the demographics in Turkey, you get a different kind of pattern. And that pattern is one that we should be hopeful about.
Ja, okay. Ja, vielen Dank. Vielen Dank, Jodi, und vielen Dank nochmal euch, den Übersetzern, ja, für diesen tollen Vortrag und die spannende Diskussion. Und alle sind eingeladen, auch morgen in der einen oder anderen Weise diese Diskussion dann fortzusetzen, ja. Und ansonsten seid ihr auch noch eingeladen, hier noch weiter ein Glas Wasser oder Wein mit uns zu trinken, ja. Okay.